Welcome to this class on Neuroscience of Human Movement. In this class, we'll be talking about primary motor cortex. So, in today's class, we'll be talking about the historical development of this field, the history of studies that discuss the functional organization of the primary motor cortex, not the entire cortex, only the primary motor cortex. The first claim towards this was made by the English neurologist Hewlings-Jackson. He suggested that a specific part of the cerebral cortex anterior to the central sulcus has a causal role in movement. How did he come up with this conclusion? So, Hewlings-Jackson was a neurologist who examined lots of patients of epilepsy. From his observations of epileptic patients, he found that movements proceeded from one part of the body to another part as if they were arranged in a temporal sequence. And each particular component of this movement resembled a natural movement. It seemed as if several natural movements were concatenated together to form the seizure-like movements that are found in epilepsy, that are characteristic of epilepsy. So, this kind of movements came to be called later as the Jacksonian march, right. So, he hypothesized that probably regions or neurons that were responsible for generating each of these discrete movements were activated in a spasm like fashion, thus concatenating other movements producing this Jacksonian march, right. So, very deep insight to have been made in the second half of the 19th century, right. A very controversial claim for that time, right. Functional organism at around the same time or just later, Fritsch and Hitzig in Berlin and Hewlings-Jackson's friend and colleague Dr. Ferrier in England studied the functional organization of the motor regions in animals, particularly dogs, right. And they found that stimulation of specific regions of the cortex produced movements in specific region of the body in animals, right. So, and then came the famous neurophysiologist Sherrington, who performed his now classical studies on the organization of motor cortex in great apes using electrical stimulation, right. So, this was of course followed by the work of Clinton Woolsey that we will discuss in future slides, right. So, in the second half of the 19th century, the first studies that implicated localization of function in the cortex were performed by Broca and Wernicke, who documented specific deficits in language when specific regions of the brain were lesioned, right. So, this gave rise to the identification of regions that now bear their name, Broca's area and Wernicke's area. Those who are interested, kindly Google and read about this, right. Then came the classical neurophysiological studies of Clinton Woolsey, who performed stimulation of specific regions of the strip of neurons that are just rostral to the central sulcus, right, or the precentral gyrus. So, he mapped the motor areas in animals. Extensive mapping of the animal motor cortex was undertaken by Clinton Woolsey and his colleagues. In humans, right, this kind of work was pursued of course by Penfield and Boldre, who documented data from 126 patients who were undergoing neurosurgery, of course, for epilepsy, cerebral cortex, and they titled their paper as Somatic Motor and Sensory Representation in the Cerebral Cortex of Man as Studied by Electrical Stimulation. This was of course published in the journal Brain that was started by Hewlings-Jackson and Ferrier and others. So, what they found was that when they activated specific regions of the motor cortex. They found activation of specific parts of the body in patients with local anesthesia. So, this was done for a large number of patients, 126 patients, and detailed records of the specific site that was stimulated and the specific response that was found was taken as notes by Boldre, and a compilation of all these things resulted in this 55-page article in Brain that is now famous. What they found was that relatively larger area in the motor cortex produced movements of the upper limb when compared with other parts of the body, right. So, essentially they found the disproportionate representation of the hand and finger regions when compared with the other regions. Actually, they also documented the movements of other regions. So, essentially depending on the number of neurons or number of stimulation sites that elicited movements of a particular part of the body, they created a proportional map of the human body, which have come to be called as the little man or the homunculus, right. This gave rise to an impression that there was a little man sitting in the brain. And activation of this little man or activation of the specific part of this little man produces movements of the bigger man, which is the actual human or this. Actually, this results represents the proportion of neurons within the precentral gyrus that were able to produce the movements in specific parts, not necessarily the exact locations. This was acknowledged by Penfield in his original paper itself, right. Of course, they also specifically recorded limitations of the cytoarchitectonic approach. And so, in other words, they said that, you know, specific regions do not correspond to specific functions. In other words, there was an overlap between, for example, sensory and motor regions in the humans when compared with the animals. So, this was another important conclusion that is often overlooked in the work of Penfield and Baldry. What else, right? So, this work was reviewed recently by Catani in the paper titled "A Little Man of Some Importance." This also came in the cover page of the November 2017 Brain issue, right. So, here in this review paper, he discusses the contribution of Penfield and Baldry and the legacy of this seminal landmark paper, right. So, what he says is that the colloquial use of this term homunculus bears the risk of mistakenly granting an existence in the realm of neuroscience. This little man, like many other figures, may naively populate our collective imagination. It is just a metaphor of the complex neurological mechanisms that we strive to comprehend in their entirety. So, what's shown is this little man, but what's hidden is the complexity. So, essentially the hidden complexity in the organization of the primary motor cortex is something that is not discussed as part of Penfield and Baldry, right. Regions of the fingers are not organized as that is discussed here, but it is actually more complicated than this. These discussions will continue in future classes. So in summary, we saw the seminal work of Hewlings-Jackson and Broca and Wernicke in starting the discussion on localization of function, and the work of Charles Sherrington in studying functional organization in the great ape cortex, and the work of Fritz Hitzig and David Ferrier in starting to study stimulation based responses in animals, the substantial contributions of Clinton Woolsey in documenting how animals responded or what specific regions of the motor cortex elicited responses in which parts of the body, right. and the contributions, of course, of Wilder Penfield in terms of producing the landmark paper on the homunculus. Right. So, with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you very much for your attention.